Hello and welcome. Bonjour et bienvenue. I'm Jacqueline Sundberg and I work with the Roar Group here at the McGill Library. That stands for Rare Books and Special Collections, the Osler Library, the Visual Arts Collection, and Archives and Records Management. Nous souhaitons ce soir bienvenue à deux invités pour une session spéciale Show and Tell, The Secrets of Women, with Caroline Boileau and Margaret Carlyle. Before we go further, some housekeeping notes. This event is bilingual, with discrete portions in French and English.
For today, we do have, as I said, two special guests. On a deux invités. Et moi, mes collègues sont ici à McGill sur notre campus, dans le centre-ville de Montréal. And this campus is situated, and McGill University is situated, on land that has long served as a place of meeting and exchange amongst nations and indigenous peoples, including the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe nations. Roar honors, recognizes, and respects these nations as the traditional stewards of the lands and waters on which we're meeting today. Today we have some opening comments from Natalie Cook, Associate Dean of Roar. We'll have some introductions from Mary Ural of the Osler Library of the History of Medicine. And we're going to have a special discussion with Caroline Boileau and Margaret Carlyle, followed by a Q&A where we can hopefully get questions from all of you attendees. So now, I will look at my notes once more and make sure I haven't missed anything and pass it over to Natalie Cook. Natalie, over to you.
Thanks so much, Jacqueline. I just wanted to thank everybody for coming. This is our last event of the year, and we're excited to have such vibrant speakers today. So thanks in advance to Caroline and Margaret for their comments. But I'd also like to thank the team that makes these events possible. And that includes Jacqueline Sundberg, who you just met, Labiba Faiza, and also Mary Earle, to whom I'm going to be passing the microphone shortly. These events are made possible by the support of donors and funding from the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada, and specifically to private donors, Ron Harvey and Doug Bagley, who have really made all these things possible. Now, I'm going to turn the virtual microphone over to Mary Earle, who is the Osler Librarian of the History of Medicine. And if you look closely behind Mary and behind Jacqueline, you're going to see something very interesting. You'll see the virtual Osler Library on both those screens, although the number of books seems to change in terms of where they're housed on the shelf. So I'll let you look at that rather interesting doubling. Over to you, Mary.
Oh, thanks so much, Natalie. And also again, thank you, Jacqueline and Labiba for making this happen. It's a pleasure to have you all in the audience, albeit virtually. We thank you also for your patience as we return to mask wearing to comply with new advice to help prevent the further spread of the virus. And we do appreciate that this makes things a bit more difficult in terms of accessibility, but we will try to speak ever more clearly. First, I also want to thank my stellar colleagues who help out often in unseen ways. At the Osler Library, document technicians Lili Stiegel and Bojena Latinčić each undertake complementary and essential work. At the end of this talk, we'll be sharing in the chat links to some of the featured items that have been digitized. And for that, we are very much indebted to Greg Houston in digital initiatives. The Osler Library itself opened in 1929. It was a bequest of about 8,000 books chosen by Sir William Osler for the medical faculty of McGill. The Biblioteca Osleriana, the original catalog for the Osler, established the library as one with a particular purpose, and that is to serve the medical community and especially medical students. In his 1905 address, The Student Life, written at about the time Osler started to collect for McGill, he shared the following inspiration for the array of works he acquired for the library, works to help medical students become global citizens. The true student is a citizen of the world. The great works transcend all limitations of time, of language, and of race. I care not in what subject he may work, the full knowledge cannot be reached without drawing on supplies from other lands than his own, French, German, American, Japanese, Russian, Italian. There must be no discrimination by the loyal student. Le véritable étudiant est un citoyen du monde. Les grandes œuvres transcendent toutes les limites du temps, de la langue et de la race. Peu importe le sujet sur lequel le travail, Il ne peut atteindre la pleine connaissance sans approvisionner dans d'autres pays que le sien. L'étudiant loyal ne doit faire aucune discrimination. He chose items for his library, each book having a specific purpose, a specific place in the history of medicine as Osler himself understood it. He wrote in the catalog's introduction, "A library represents the mind of its collector, his fancies and foibles, his strength, his weakness, his prejudices and preferences. Une bibliothèque représente l'esprit de son collectionneur, ses fantaisies et ses manies, sa force et sa faiblesse, ses préjugés et ses préférences." Our library does reflect the preferences and prejudices of Osler, and it likewise reflects the medical student body during Osler's years as a student and professor at McGill, male, white, Christian for the most part. But Osler intended his library to be dynamic, to change as medicine changed and as the medical student body changed. So our collections today reflect their origins, but they've grown. And a lot of what our speakers today will talk about are the ways in which knowledge and our interpretation of it is dynamic. Moving towards the speakers, today's events underscore the importance, which Natalie referenced, of donors to the McGill Library, and specifically in my case, to the Osler Library. I know both Margaret Carlisle and Caroline Boileau because they were selected as recipients of various awards. Margaret was the recipient of an Edward H. Bensley Travel Grant in 2018 and a Mary Louise Nickerson Travel Grant in 2019. Caroline Boileau was the 2018 Michel Larose Osler Library Artist in Residence. So, elles ont toutes deux été récompensées pour leur travail à la Bibliothèque Osler. Margaret pour effectuer des recherches historiques, et Caroline était l'artiste en résidence Michel Larose en 2018, pour laquelle un grand merci à Dr. Larose pour son soutien. Margaret Carlisle is an assistant professor of history of science and technology at the University of British Columbia, Okanagan. Her research interests include women in science, midwifery, and medical images. She is currently preparing two books. The first is a cultural history of anatomy in 18th century France, and the second is a history of childbirth technologies entitled Delivering the Enlightenment. Caroline Boileau est une artiste visuelle qui vit et travaille à Montréal. À travers ses projets multidisciplinaires, elle s'intéresse à différentes façons de comprendre et d'appréhender la santé. Le corps hybride, les multiples représentations du corps, celui de la femme en particulier, sont des thèmes récurrents dans sa recherche. Inspirée par l'histoire de l'art, l'histoire de la médecine, des sciences et de l'actualité. Margaret and Carolyn, please take it away and thank you.
Great.
Thank merci. You so much. Ah, merci. Oui, merci.
Really happy to be here. And before we get down to business and actually do the show and tell of the documents and the precious manuscripts, as well as some objects from the Osler's beautiful, amazing collection, we just want to say a few words about the actual title or the concept that we're thinking about in the next half hour, 45 minutes, which is the idea of the secrets of women or les secrets de la femme. So I'm a historian of medicine and of gender. So when we think about the idea of the secrets of women in the history of medicine, we think about typically two different things. One thing we often think about is the concept that women's organs of generation, especially before dissections of cadavers, was made mainstream, in the Western tradition at least, from about the 16th century or 1500s onwards. Prior to this period, there was a lot of mystery around the organs of generation inside of women because they were seen to be very internal. They were seen to be hidden, and they were seen to be sort of mysterious. And that once we started opening up and actually dissecting cadavers, we started to learn a lot more about those secrets, and they were less secret and they were sort of demystified. A second concept that we think about in the history of medicine when we think about secrets of women or women of secrets are actually the kind of recipes, the medical and proprietary recipes that women had and held since time immemorial to deal with childbirth, to deal with domestic medicine, and so on and so forth. So all the different kinds of healing herbals and medicines and pharmaceuticals that women as sort of wise women or folk women developed without any kind of university medical training is, in my mind, a second definition of secret in the context of the history of medicine.
Oui, tout à fait. Puis le, je pense que ça reste, cette parole des femmes, ça reste un secret encore, je trouve, aujourd'hui, à démystifier, puis à se réapproprier comme femme. À tout vouloir révéler du corps, à vouloir révéler les secrets des femmes par la médecine, à vouloir tout montrer, on finit peut-être à un moment donné par montrer, par représenter mal. À un moment donné, on perd l'humain, on perd la femme à vouloir trop montrer les fragments du corps. Puis je pense que, en tout cas moi, d'un point de vue d'artiste visuel, j'ai un amour, un grand amour de ces documents anciens, de ces représentations du corps qui datent de plusieurs siècles parfois. Mais j'aime bien les confronter à des paroles de femmes d'aujourd'hui qui prennent la parole elles-mêmes pour raconter leur corps. Puis une des questions, moi, qui m'habite beaucoup, c'est comment on fait comme femme aujourd'hui pour pas perpétuer des façons d'aborder le corps de la femme qui sont issues d'une culture qui est patriarcale, qui était souvent misogyne. Donc, c'est ça, se réapproprier nos secrets.
Parfait, thank you. So we're going to share our screen now so that you can actually take in the different documents and rare books that we have selected for today's show and tell. We're going to share our screen and be on our way in just a moment.
Moi, je vais continuer à parler. Oui. Je peux dire que moi, comme artiste, j'aborde ces documents-là, puis surtout les illustrations de ces ouvrages scientifiques et médicaux. Je vois ces illustrations, puis pour moi, ce sont des œuvres d'art à part entière. J'ai vraiment une fascination pour ces images qui sont à la fois d'une grande beauté et d'une grande violence. Et il y a toujours, pour moi, ce sont des images troubles. Je suis toujours entre les deux. Puis je pense que c'est vraiment des représentations du corps, bon, du corps de la femme en particulier aujourd'hui, des illustrations, des images qu'on gagne à voir, à revoir, à revisiter. D'une part, pour mesurer le chemin parcouru, puis en tout cas pour moi personnellement aussi, pour reposer la question de la place de la femme dans la société. Donc, on revient à ce super document. Alors, je vous redonne les informations. Johann Jakob Huber, donc, publié en 1742 en latin. Peut-être que je vous montre juste quelques pages rapidement de ce magnifique document. Et on s'en va vers la toute fin. Donc, ici. Ah, et puis là, on attend que le... Ah, voilà.
Focused. Non. Bon.
Et là, on déplie. Là, il va falloir. C'est vraiment un show and tell. Oui, ça fait partie du secret. Donc, on déplie tout ça. Peut-être qu'on est mieux de tirer le plateau complètement. Est-ce que tu es capable? Bon, ça va être une image un peu imparfaite. Mais là, en dépliant cette grande gravure qui fait partie du livre qui est inséré à la toute fin, on se retrouve avec une image d'utérus aplati. L'utérus est ouvert, aplati. On a soulevé les moindres petits recoins pour tout montrer, jusque dans les moindres détails. Donc, il y a même des tiges qui ont été insérées pour garder le tout ouvert. Je ne sais pas si on voit les petits clous. Les petits clous. On voit les petits clous dans le coin ici.
Little nails used to hold down human flesh as part of the process of actually transcribing what was seen from the dissected cadaver onto the page.
Donc voilà.
There's certainly an element of unfolding here.
Oui. Puis la femme, à part cet utérus complètement aplati, c'est ça. La femme, elle est absente. C'est un organe désincarné.
So that source, we wanted to show it to you to show how we sort of have to actually open up the secrets of women in the way that you open up a beautiful engraved plate like that of the female uterus. From a work that, as Kathleen mentioned, was by a very sort of erudite Latin obstetrician, or he was writing in Latin rather, And so there's an element there of the impenetrability of knowledge and the secrecy of who gets to hold knowledge about the female body. And so from now on, we're going to show you a few different sources to highlight this theme of secrecy. For the next two tables or engravings that we want to show you are from George Spratt. And you can see here, it says George Spratt, surgeon accoucheur and supplement to obstetric tables. Now, George Spratt is an important late 18th century, early 19th century surgeon accoucheur in England. He was a member of the Royal College of Surgeons. And he was something of a maverick because on the one hand, he did have training in medicine and surgery and obstetrics, but ultimately he was a really keen printer and artist. And it, in some ways, these obstetric tables are as much a monument to print and print culture as they are to obstetrics. This is the 1835 edition of the obstetric tables. And we want to highlight one particular what we call a flap anatomy. Just move it over a bit here so you can see. The focus is okay.
Oui, je pense que ça prend juste un petit peu de temps si je le
takes a minute to focus.
On va attendre un petit peu. Est-ce que j'essaie ça ici?
Or that locks it. So I think we don't want to lock.
Okay, no.
Okay, let's put my hand here. Sometimes it helps it focus. Yeah,
that's much voilà, better. On y... Ah non, ça reprend. On essaie ce bouton-ci. Ah, là, ça va.
Okay. I think we'll leave our hands for just a second. Oui. So,
ah non, regarde, on le perd. Ah. Attends, on va le là c'est voilà. Okay, je l'ai. Ah non, oui, c'est bon.
Yeah, locked. So this one is really, really fantastic. So the concept of what we call a flap anatomy, a piece that has many layers of flaps that have been carefully and precisely printed and then actually glued into a book like this, which is ostensibly a textbook meant for training primarily male surgeons in obstetrics, in sort of gynecology and obstetrics. These flaps, they're not new technology in the 1830s when Thomas Spratt is mm-hmm. publishing this book. They're actually known technology, but as far as we know, they went out of favor during the 18th century, during the 1700s. And so Thomas Spratt's obstetric tables is quite remarkable in kind of bringing back that tradition, bringing back that technology. And what he adds to it is he publishes this beautiful engraving using lithography, a technology using stone and kind of oil and water. So he is adding layers to it quite literally to the technology and layers quite literally to these flaps. So very delicately, we can lift the flaps. And the idea is that the person learning using this sort of textbook would lift the flaps mm-hmm. one at a time very carefully in order to see the development of the fetus in utero. And the goal here, of course, is to penetrate the different layers of the female and to see also the progression of gestation and how changes happen over the 9 months of gestation mm-hmm. to the bodily exterior. And then ultimately we get into the actual uterus and the bodily interior with a kind of X-ray vision into the body. And yeah, thanks. So you can see here, if we very carefully lift up the flaps, we see a full-term fetus in utero. And it might be a little tricky to see the actual coloring, but it's beautifully colored with sort of red and blue and white and sort of etching. What's also fascinating in terms of thinking about the secrets of women is that we're sort of penetrating into the female body and we're seeing the fetus in utero here. But it's also important to remark on the woman herself. Right. And this is the name of the person, of the patient, isn't mentioned in the text. But we know it's a sort of Victorian era female who has kind of all the trappings of someone doing a kind of striptease. And I don't know if you want to say a bit more about that.
Mais c'est fascinant de, parce qu'on est, c'est un ouvrage médical, donc c'est un ouvrage scientifique. Et on est devant ce striptease un petit peu affriolant. Elle soulève son vêtement, elle a le petit bonnet de dentelle, le petit ruban bleu qui tient tout ça en place. C'est très étrange de voir ces représentations-là ensemble. À la fois la jeune femme affriolante et avec les rabats de découvrir bon son corps enceinte à différentes étapes de la grossesse, après son pénètre à l'intérieur de son corps. Donc c'est un bien étrange, une bien mm-hmm. étrange, bien étrange illustration. Alors après. Un autre, document de Sprott, celui-ci de 1850, donc un petit peu plus tard. Et puis ici, on n'est plus dans l'espèce de petit côté affriolant, des petits vêtements de dentelle. On est dans quelque chose d'un tout autre ordre. Est-ce qu'on a un autre? Ah oui, ça c'est bien. Un autre petit serpent, voilà. Alors ici encore, on a une image avec des rabats. Puis là, vous remarquez les mains avec des instruments, l'espèce de forceps avec des dents en bas de la page. On est dans un autre type d'image. Donc, à mesure qu'on ouvre les rabats, on entre de plus en plus profondément à l'intérieur du corps. Puis ces rabats sont vraiment, c'est extraordinaire en termes d'ingénierie du travail du papier, de l'impression que les images concordent. Voilà, et on arrive.
So here you can see what are clearly meant to be gendered as male obstetrical hands, and he's manipulating his instrument, which is pictured at the bottom, the obstetrical forceps with the kind of famous jaw marks on it, the teeth you can see here at the bottom, to show the kind of the power of the instrument. And these are kind of cold, rational metal instruments that were seen at the time to add a kind of science and rationality to obstetrics that was sort of gendered as male, and it was mostly male obstetricians that were using them and implementing them. So here we can see the kind of power of the instrument interfacing with the secrets of women. And there's an element of secrecy as well in a different vein. We can see at the top of the flap and the engraving, which is a kind of modesty, modesty sheet that would have been, you know, held over the woman until the moment of parturition or labor. And then there is a kind of unveiling going on there in this actual engraving, which is sort of interesting in terms of our theme of the secrets of women.
Oui. Oui, right. Puis c'est ça. Puis aussi, c'est important de remarquer qu'on a une fraction seulement du corps de la femme. Elle est découpée pour la page.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, disembodied female torso is a very common trope in obstetrics, obstetrical atlases from about the late 1700s onwards. So now we're actually going to complement this look at the male obstetrical kind of invention of the forceps and the standardization and, I guess, routinization of the forceps, if you will, by looking at a really fantastic part of the collection, which are the obstetrical instruments themselves, the kind of armamentarium, if you will, of the obstetrician. And we hope the focus is going to work for us.
Oui, looks like it's doing well.
And so here we have a variety of instruments that are from a very particular and interesting person to the Osler Library and to McGill University in general. They were owned and, I guess, donated to the collection by Professor William Wright. And he actually was a medical student at McGill who graduated in 1848, so in the middle of the 19th century. After he graduated with his medical degree, he taught at McGill University throughout the 1850s. And he taught primarily the subject of materia medica, or sort of pharmacology, if you will, here at McGill University for about 30 years. So he had a very storied and long career as a medical practitioner before later in his life becoming actually an Anglican pastor. But what's also very interesting about him is the fact that he was biracial. And at the time he identified as mulatto, and he had a father who was a black drummer in the British Army. So he represents a sort of pioneering figure at the McGill medical faculty for several reasons, but one of them was being biracial and joining the faculty in 1848 upon graduation. And so here he has his obstetrical instruments that Carolyn just showed. We have the obstetrical.
On a les ciseaux.
Yeah.
Le speculum.
Yep, speculum. Et forceps.
Les forceps ici.
Yeah.
Puis là, en tout cas, je trouve que c'est toujours fascinant de voir les instruments en vrai. Là, vous les voyez par l'écran, mais de voir la taille, les instruments métalliques, de les voir en relation avec, avec le corps, plutôt que seulement représentés graphiquement sur des illustrations de.
And the forceps at this time, there were many varieties of forceps. There were sort of a technology that were always in transition, and there were curved forceps, straight forceps, and various others.
Ceux qu'on a vus avec les dents.
Yeah.
On espérerait une meilleure technologie aujourd'hui, en 2021. Ça va venir sûrement. Alors, on est rendu au... Madame de Coudray, ici, 3A. Attends, je me suis... C'est peut-être celui-là, le premier? J'ai plus le... Oui. Oui, parfait. Donc, ici, on a... Madame de Coudray... Angélique Marguerite Le Boursier de Coudray. Un abrégé des arts de l'accouchement, publié en 1769. Puis là, ici, ça, c'est magnifique, on a son portrait. Dans les ouvrages de l'époque, on a souvent le portrait du médecin, c'est toujours des hommes qui sont représentés sur leurs plus beaux atours avec de super beaux vêtements. C'est vraiment, c'est magnifique de voir une femme dans cet ouvrage-ci. Puis toi, tu peux en parler, tu peux nous parler d'elle un petit peu avant qu'on
Madame de Coudray regarde le livre. Fascinating woman. She was really the midwife of the 18th century, who kind of persisted in the traditions of midwifery around the time of the male takeover of the profession, not only in France, where she was working and training midwives, both male and female, but across sort of Europe and in sort of Western medical tradition. Now, it's remarkable that she has a portrait, as Catherine mentioned, and the title page. But what's also remarkable is that she sold this textbook to accompany her mannequin. So she produced actual three-dimensional models of the female birthing body that she actually sold for, you know, to earn a bit of a living, but more importantly, to train medical men and midwives in the different positions, the different fetal positions during delivery. And the idea was that you would buy her Abrégé de l'art des accouchements, this book, this textbook, which is almost a pocket-sized format. And the idea was that you would buy this and you would use the engravings, the beautiful color engravings that we're going to show you, in order to complement the mannequin. So you would get the sort of man that you'd have the mannequin on one hand, and then you have the book to consult for different fetal positions.
On pourrait peut-être aussi mentionner que ces mannequins étaient faits en tissu, en bois. Là aussi, en tout cas pour moi, on est vraiment devant des objets qu'elle voulait utilitaires, mais qui sont aujourd'hui vraiment des œuvres absolument incroyables qui sont faciles à regarder là, sur Internet. Si vous faites une recherche, ça vaut la peine. Mais de voir la beauté des objets, de ces organes de tissu, le fœtus en tissu. Donc, c'est entre le mannequin, la poupée. Puis, il y a une douceur aussi qu'on remarque déjà, là, si on pense aux documents, aux illustrations de Spratt juste avant, avec cette représentation aussi.
Yeah, it is remarkable because even though she still has the kind of disembodied female uterus and pelvis, which is a common motif in the visuals in obstetrics of this period, she does have a kind of light touch and, dare we say, feminine touch in some of her other engravings where she shows beautiful. And here I think it's kind of remarkable she has the disembodied hands of the practitioner, which in this case, unlike with the Spratt, are meant to be female hands. And we were sort of looking at these earlier and noticing the frilly kind of feminine markers, if you will. But also interestingly, there's, you know, veins that you can look at and see. And we sort of concluded this shows that she is a sage femme. She literally is a wise practitioner who, through many, many years of experience in practicing midwifery and then passing it on through her pedagogical tools, including this textbook and her actual three-dimensional mannequin, she was providing knowledge to the next generation, and that she really was the kind of wisest of women. And you see that in her kind of very hard-earned manual dexterity in her hands.
Et c'est fort, cette image-là, des mains de femmes qui sont en train de soutenir, d'accueillir l'enfant. On est très loin des mains qui vont pénétrer le vagin jusque dans l'utérus. Avec des forceps, je pense aux illustrations tout à l'heure. Ici, ce sont des mains douces qui accueillent, qui soutiennent, qui accompagnent. Il y a quelque chose de très, très beau. Puis comme tu disais, de voir les veines, donc on se dit que c'est vraiment une femme d'expérience. Clairement des mains de femme, ce qui est très beau et très rare dans toutes ces illustrations.
Yeah, I think Madame du Courret was probably one of very few women, at least in sort of the European midwifery tradition, in this period to not only be practicing, but to be promoting herself, having a kind of commercial business, and then to publish her own book with her portrait in it. There were other women like Justina Siegmund in the German speaking lands. She published a textbook that was illustrated like this. It was not colored. This is a more lavish kind of production, but she certainly didn't include necessarily as much kind of commercialization as du Coudray did, who clearly wanted to promote her brand really in this. This one's beautiful. It's the last one we'll show you from Madame du Coudray's.
Magnifique. Donc les vous allez sur le dans le chat, vous allez recevoir les liens, des liens vers les documents numérisés de tous ces livres. Puis ça vaut vraiment la peine là, de passer. On est avec.
So
alors.
It would be interesting to pair the Madame du Coudray, the obstetrical kind of textbook, if you will, par excellence, from the 18th century, with a later and very unique, because it's a manuscript, it's not a printed book, it's a handwritten, what we might call commonplace book. So a kind of an agenda of sorts with sort of everyday domestic and personal experiences of a woman named Mrs. Parnell. And we don't know that much about her. We know she was from Ontario. And we know that she prepared this commonplace book between 1908 and 1913. So sort of just before the Great War. And what we find remarkable about this, besides all of the sort of just entry, day-to-day entries, is the sort of moment about partway, not quite halfway through the book, where she provides some very interesting sort of domestic recipes. And it should be clear enough to you, but hopefully you can look at the top here and see what it says. It says, to get rid of kids. So clearly she has developed a kind of list of recipes, truly the kind of ultimate secrets of women, pharmaceutical secrets of women, on potential ways effectively to kind of return the menses, as was a euphemism in the period and until recently for an abortion. So she provides her recipes in the middle. She seems to be very forthright about it. I think that's what surprised me, is that she didn't even try to hide it or code her recipes. She just said how to get rid of kids.
Oui, moi, ce document-là, je trouve absolument fascinant parce que là, on est vraiment, comme tu disais, dans les secrets de cette femme-là. Donc, c'est cette section qui est cachée à peu près au tiers du livre, se débarrasser des enfants, c'est clairement indiqué. Elle l'a souligné, c'est le titre. Donc, c'est caché dans le petit carnet, mais c'est pas nécessairement caché. Moi, je me dis que ça devait être un carnet qu'elle avait sur elle en tout temps. Absolument incroyable d'avoir des informations sur sa vie, sur les livres qu'elle lisait, les gens qu'elle rencontrait, le nom des gens qu'elle rencontrait. Donc, vraiment un petit bouquin de tous les jours avec des listes d'épicerie, le prix des aliments et cette section. Puis c'est magnifique, ces histoires, ces recettes qui sont passées de femme à femme par la tradition orale. Les recettes qui sont transcrites dans un petit carnet qu'on garde sur soi au cas où. Il y a quelque chose de vraiment touchant là-dedans de cette femme qui s'occupe de sa propre santé, en fait.
And if we turn the page, we can actually see, if you scan to the end of the page, she gives a very particular and sort of, you know, very forthright, probably in keeping with her just, you know, no-nonsense approach to all this. She says at the bottom, gunpowder and whiskey and take freely was potential kind of her last, you know, big remedy for quote unquote getting rid of kids. So gunpowder, whiskey, and take freely. I'm not sure how that all combines into a cocktail.
Je
but
sais
we'll
pas,
give it
mais
to the
c'est ça, de la poudre de la poudre à fusil en fait, avec du whisky à boire allègrement.
So I think we find her fascinating because she pairs really well with Madame du Coudray, because she really was a kind of pioneering woman trying to develop something in her own sort of field of expertise, which was effectively kind of women's medicine, domestic medicine. And you didn't have to have a medical degree to do that.
No.
Just as much as Madame du Coudray was kind of on the fringes of like male obstetrical practice, she never got to go to a kind of faculty of medicine to enroll in formal university courses.
Et on a pu, en tout cas pour... Je pense qu'on a peu de documents comme ça, de paroles de femmes, d'histoires de femmes le fait que ce soit un manuscrit, que ça soit, que ça arrive jusqu'à nous, c'est extrêmement précieux parce que, à part Madame de Coudray, qui a pu éditer, publier un livre, c'est, ça reste rare. Et là, on a le petit.
The Shibata. Second last major item to show.
Alors, on est ici dans un... Bon, c'est un livre qui est édité, évidemment, mais on conserve l'idée du carnet de notes à conserver sur soi, assez petit pour que ça puisse rentrer dans une poche. Alors, ici, c'est vraiment un petit carnet pratique. Le Pocket Phantom de Dr. Shibata. Donc ici, il y a toute une série d'illustrations, des positions en fait du fœtus. Puis c'est intéressant, les pages blanches ont été laissées là pour que le médecin qui utilise le document puisse rédiger des notes, puisse consigner toutes sortes d'informations. Donc on a les différentes positions du fœtus ici. Et pour... encourager en fait les médecins à palper l'abdomen des femmes durant l'accouchement, à déterminer quelle était la position du fœtus. Il y avait un autre petit outil à la fin. Alors je te laisse.
Yeah, these are beautiful.
Oui.
So what's really fascinating, we can say about this particular edition. So the Osler Library actually has two editions of the Shibata, the Koichi. His name was Koichi Shibata, and I'll say a bit about him in a minute. But we have two different editions of this, and they're identical. You have, you know, a pair of marionettes or fetuses. But what's interesting about this edition is that it was prepared by a McGill professor who was the chair of midwifery in the 19th century, early 20th century, and his name was J.C. Cameron. So there's another interesting McGill connection here. And the idea is that these mannequins or kind of marionettes that have articulated joints, we have to be very careful with them, can be used to show the different fetal positions and how they go through the birthing passage, but in particular, the pelvis. And the pelvis was kind of, it was sort of fetishized in this period. And there was this notion of disembodying the female patient or the maternal figure from the pelvis. And the reason, clinically speaking, why the pelvis was so much an object of focus was because the first point of interaction during labor or during parturition is between the kind of fetal skull, which if you look very closely and faintly, there are sort of dotted lines with different measurements of the fetal skull and its interaction with the upper kind of inlet or the delta of the pelvis. And that was really an obsession of practitioners because if the pelvic girth was just too narrow or the fetal skull was too big or both, then you had a problem in terms of delivery. So there was certainly something interesting here. What's also interesting is that Koichi Shibata, the author of the text, he himself is an interesting character in the history of medicine because he was Japanese and he studied at the University of Munich. So the other edition we have is actually in German, not surprisingly. And he wanted to pass on his knowledge and training to his students in this kind of two-dimensional form. So we kind of moved from, you know, the mannequins of Madame de Coudray that were three-dimensional to these two-dimensional objects, which have some kind of, you know, or kinematic or motion aspect to them and are really, really special.
Donc, ça devait pouvoir passer ici. Là, je le ferai pas parce que c'est quand même très, très fragile, mais... L'idée, c'était vraiment de pouvoir soulever ici le rabat donc, et de faire passer carrément le fœtus dans le bassin. Et donc, de tester la position, la meilleure position pour l'accouchement.
Yeah.
Et ils sont... Je veux juste parler de la beauté de ces objets-là. Donc, on a vraiment ces petits mannequins recto verso. Puis la confection de ces objets-là est absolument incroyable. Je vais juste le déplier un petit peu pour vous montrer parce que c'est complètement fou. Là. Il y a même le mouvement comme ça latéral. Donc les deux mannequins ont des positions légèrement différentes. Voilà.
Maybe I could say a few words about the concept of a phantom or a pocket phantom.
Oui, ça serait super intéressant. Oui.
So in the broader context of obstetrical training at this time, so we're talking about, you know, the first edition was published in 1891. The edition we have here is from 1903, the English sort of Canadian edition by this McGill professor. And there's various editions in German, French, and other languages, right? It was very popular, the Shibata mm-hmm. pocket phantom. And they always included the key peeps, which is the actual, the phantoms. And the idea that these are kind of phantoms or specters of ghosts, they're not real fetuses, just as much as the female body in a phantom three-dimensional form is not a real body, but it's a stand-in or kind of like a simulation. So we're also getting into kind of new layers of secrecy, sort of how do you imitate the human form and the actual, you know, dexterity required to deliver a fetus to deliver in the delivery room? And how do you translate that kind of, you know, the classroom clinical experience, how do you translate it? And this was meant to be, you know, accompanying with clinical experience. So I think the idea was you would actually be in situ delivering an infant or observing it being delivered by the person or the professor training you, and then you would use these to try to match the positions and maybe practice on your own.
Et c'est incroyable de penser que ce petit livre se retrouvait dans la poche d'un médecin qui le sort durant un accouchement, qui va du corps de la femme à cette oui. espèce de petite architecture de papier pour essayer de faire passer le... trouver la bonne position pour faire passer le... pour faire passer le fœtus pour la naissance.
If you want to show the pocket.
Oui, on va peut-être pouvoir juste... Yeah.
Okay. So this is the famous
oui, la petite poche. Donc, ils sont installés ici yeah. très confortablement. Les petits amis.
The pocket actually sort of seems like a stand in the uterus, you know, while you're waiting oui. to test it out or to jog your memory.
Oui.
When this book is literally in your pocket and the fetuses are inside a literal pocket, there's something also about secrecy
oui, c'est vrai.
And unveiling.
Oui. I think
that's really interesting.
Mais tout à fait.
And I guess for obstetrical training, you could use two-dimensional kind of objects like this, three-dimensional objects. And of course, ideally, you would get clinical training, like actually in a birthing room. But often that wasn't possible. And there were lots of reasons why students actually didn't get to train, you know, hands-on. So these, believe it or not, these were not toys. They really were
c'est
training ça. Tools.
Et c'est incroyable de penser qu'on peut c'est ça là, penser à un aide pour des jeunes médecins, pour des médecins en salle d'accouchement. Mais là, le corps de la femme, on le réduit à un os de bassin, des petits fœtus de papier. On est loin d'un corps en trois dimensions, un corps qui bouge, qui respire, qui parle. Mais ça reste que c'est un document tout à fait remarquable. Donc voilà.
Yeah. So we're going to show just for the last. We just have a few more minutes here before we open.
Qu'est-ce qu'il nous reste comme
questions.
Ah oui, c'est bon.
And we're actually going to pivot, technologically speaking, from where we've been showing you on our
oui.
tray here, the smaller objects. We're going to go from the pocket-sized phantom all
oui.
the way to the largest source,
le petit.
The very tiny pocket phantom to the large folio. And we just have our technician helping us. Thank you, Jacqueline.
Je laisse mes mains pour comprendre un petit peu le saut qu'on va faire mm-hmm. en termes de taille des documents. Est-ce que ça va fonctionner? Ah oui, oui, oui. Ah.
Fantastic.
Ah oui, c'est super. Ah, je peux juste décrocher mon micro ici.
So, okay. So now Caroline and I were with a beautiful large scale printed anatomy atlas, and it's by Lycurène de Coulet, a kind of contemporary of her from France, and his name was Fabien Gauthier, Jacques Fabien Gauthier de Gauthier, and he published this work in the middle of the 18th century. Mm-hmm. And sort of like Thomas Spratt, he's a really interesting figure in the history of medicine, but also in the history of print technology and print culture, because like Thomas Spratt in England in the sort of turn of the 20th century, in the mid 18th century, Gautier de Gautier was really interested as much in anatomy as actually printing plates. So he was as much an anatomist as he was a printmaker and a printer. And he was known for creating a really novel image and look with the what they call the mezzotint printing technique. And he kind of mapped on different colors into it. So he added color to a tradition that was already around, and that was part of his novelty. And it's hard to see here, but you can actually see the kind of the ink kind of wiping off the side of the plates. Right. And he was trying to align the plates as he printed them to make sure all the color came through. And obviously the result is something that's just really, really beautiful.
On peut voir sur certains, là ça va être trop difficile à l'écran, mais vraiment sur un des pieds, on voit que les plaques, en fait, on imprime une première plaque avec une couleur sur le papier. Après ça, il y a une autre plaque qui est ancrée avec une autre couleur qui vient s'imprimer sur le même papier. Mais là, on voit que parfois, le repérage des plaques n'était pas tout à fait exact. Ça donne un peu un petit effet brumeux de l'image. Mais c'est vraiment intéressant de voir. Déjà là, on a toute la femme sur la page. On voit tout son corps. La taille du document, c'est assez incroyable parce qu'on est presque devant une représentation taille nature d'une femme. Mais en même temps, c'est une femme qui est tout à fait idéalisée. Les seins qui sont déposés, en fait, qui sont vraiment des sphères déposées sur son corps. Là, je sais que c'est difficile à voir sur l'écran, mais je vous encourage à aller consulter les documents numérisés. Puis son regard, en fait, qui est totalement en contraste avec le bas du corps qui est ouvert, dans lequel on pénètre visuellement vraiment profondément.
Yeah, I think we'll pass to questions now.
Oui, je pense qu'on est prête, oui.
We're happy to answer questions about this one, which we went over a bit quickly at the end, but we are happy to answer questions about anything. Mm-hmm.
Est-ce qu'on... Oui, parfait. On se réinstalle. J'aime bien quand on voit.
Just takes a moment for the questions to come through.
Oui, c'est parfait.
You can offer additional things while they do. I know Jacqueline earlier had asked in the chat whether it's unusual with the sprat that the woman is wearing a bonnet.
Moi, j'ai pas l'expérience d'historienne de Margaret, mais moi, j'ai vu quelques documents avec des rabats où les femmes étaient quand même complètement vêtues, avec une, puis même on pouvait soulever la robe, soulever le jupon, et il y avait toujours cette petite coiffe, mais ça reste. Il y en a pas beaucoup, mais j'en ai vu quelques-uns. Mm-hmm. C'est très intriguant de trouver ça dans un livre médical, mais bon, il y a quelque chose de spectaculaire aussi là. C'est des livres qui étaient sûrement aussi oui, mais yeah. Mais pour un qui était peut-être pensé pour un lectorat beaucoup plus large, yes, que seulement des médecins.
Yeah, so I think part of it is that so Spratt was trying to make a career and actually make money off the publication of the textbook. So I think for him, yes, you want to provide like medically accurate information, right? But you also want to make something that was literally sexy. So mm-hmm. I think there's an element of kind of playing with maybe some ideas of Victorian prudery and the idea of it being immoral possibly for a man to touch a female body, except in the context of medicine that would deem just acceptable enough. So I suppose here there's like an element of kind of playing with the erotic and the titillating side of things, being able to show a female body nude. And then I think the fact that she's clothed adds a kind of striptease to that, because there's no medical reason that she needs to be wearing a bonnet. And I think that it's just slipping into the kind of erotic. And there are other sources I've seen in the 19th century that are not of the fully clothed, embodied woman, but of the kind of torso, the butcher meat torso, the disembodied pelvis. And one of those I found at another library was with lock and key. So you actually had to get a lock key to unlock it to open it. And there was an idea that only certain people's eyes should be able to gaze onto these materials, and it should really be medical men training to become obstetricians or gynecologists. So that to me actually adds more layers of secrecy, right? The idea that something could be forbidden material. And sometimes they actually took the textbook during class and locked it into a cabinet in between classes, so that none of the, you know, male medical students could play around with the sources and maybe look at things in a pornographic or erotic way. But we know that it's Susan Tanzu, I think.
Ah oui, c'est là, yeah. C'est là, c'est certain.
Okay. And I do have another one. I'm also just going to briefly say someone had asked if we can show the Gautier Dagot team more directly. I guess maybe Jacqueline's trying to do that. I was going to say, otherwise, I would encourage you to look at the link of the digitized book that's in the chat earlier up. But the question that I'm going to feed you first while that's being set up is, I'm curious what you think about the status of reproduction in relation to these images. What additional violence or revealing or unveiling is accomplished through the use of reproductive media in particular?
So the question is about violence, the kind of inherent violence involved in this kind of imagery.
Yeah, and the reproduction, yeah. Sort of the way that it's reproduced as well, I think, in the production almost of these works.
I'll start if that's okay. I would say, especially in the context of the Sprat, which is those flap anatomies, the background to it historically is the Industrial Revolution. And I think there's an element of accentuating the idea that the female is a kind of vessel of reproduction, a vessel of social reproduction, that she can almost be reduced to like a mechanism or machine, like the machines that are part of industrial reproduction and mechanics of that. And I think that does a violence to the female body. I think that that metaphor that the female body is a machine for social reproduction strips the female of agency. And you see that in these disembodied kinds of images, right? The idea that the patient doesn't have a name and in many cases a face. Mm-hmm. And if she does have a face, it's to be for some kind of striptease or possibly sexually erotic or charged element. So I think there's a kind of physical violence done to the body by sort of cleaving and chopping and disembodying the parts, but also a kind of maybe underlying sexual violence or sexual innuendo that's not really about female agency in these images. And there's some contrast to be made, I think, between images produced by male practitioners and female midwives maybe to be made.
Oh, oui, mais tout à fait. Mais cette violence-là, moi, je trouve qu'elle est... Elle est là d'un document à l'autre. Dans le document de Madame de Coudray, c'est tellement intéressant de voir que là, déjà, on a une différence, même dans la façon dont les mains soutiennent ou attendent en relation avec le fœtus qui passe à travers le bassin. On est loin des mains de Spratt qui sont carrément insérées dans le vagin. Mais c'est ça, la violence, ben tu l'as super bien dit, là, je ne vais pas répéter ce que tu as dit, mais c'est cette idée que la femme, elle est réduite à un objet et qu'on n'a plus d'identité, on ne sait pas, même dans des illustrations, des livres qui sont beaucoup plus récents, on ne sait pas qui étaient ces femmes, quelle vie elles ont eue. Donc oui, moi il y a une violence à ces images, mais ça fait partie de l'histoire de la médecine, ça fait partie, je pense que nous comme femmes, aujourd'hui femmes contemporaines, on doit notre santé à toutes ces femmes qui ont subi, qui ont subi toutes ces choses, et on, c'est ça, c'est bon de se le faire rappeler, pour que ça change aussi, pour mesurer le chemin parcouru, mais pour être vigilant, que ça soit pas reconduit.
I think in a more positive note, like the unsung heroines, I would say, of the history of medicine are exactly the women that you're pointing out that we don't know about in the archival records and sources. And as much as we should give credit to the doctors who pioneered technologies that might now help us as women today, it's important to remember all those women whose voices we don't know. And I think that's part of the goal of this session, is to think about the secrets of women and the knowledge that women hold and give to this kind of this history and to art, to inspire artworks in a way that shows the silences in the archives and in the historical record, but also the potential to find new stories and to write about them.
Et comment on transmet nos secrets, notre puis je dirais même la connaissance qu'on a de notre corps comme femme, comment on la transmet à d'autres femmes. Ça s'est fait par la tradition orale, beaucoup. Donc, on a perdu la plupart de ces... S'il y avait eu des transcriptions, on n'en a pas ou on en a trop peu. Mais c'est intéressant de réfléchir à ça. Qu'est-ce qu'on fait pour cette transmission qui est importante?
Well, I'm going to jump in here, partly because we have lots of questions. I'm afraid we won't get to all of them. We're going to run out of time very shortly here at 5 p.m. because it's been such an interesting discussion and one that I hope can continue. We will share, as Mary has been doing, the links to the digitized resources. I have one final question. I moved the document camera just now and there were three pink objects that were sitting on the base of it that are now sitting in front of you. Can you tell me what those are? Because those are not from our rare collection, I believe.
Je sais pas comment. Est-ce qu'on le voit bien ici?
Yeah, you can see them. Yeah. Yeah.
Parfait. Caroline. Donc, c'est une représentation en trois dimensions d'un clitoris qui a été imprimé par une imprimante 3D à Victoria, en Colombie-Britannique, par l'équipe de Hélène Caz pour le projet Perfecta. Donc, c'est rare.
So it's a very, very contemporary object as opposed to the books that you
produce. 3D technology, printed of a clitoris.
Oui. Et there là, on est vraiment dans un secret de la femme.
Yeah, this is the true finale of secrets.
Oui, c'est ça. Alors, c'est la... Oui, c'est ça. On sait pas. On sait très, très peu à quoi ressemble un clitoris avec...
So this is an artistic representation?
Non, c'est pas une représentation artistique.
It's real.
C'est vraiment une représentation
scientifique.
C'est imprimé en rose, j'en conviens, mais c'est pas un objet nécessairement artistique.
Okay. Well, thank you for clarifying that for us. We looked at so many interesting books today, and I just want to extend an enormous thank you to the two of you and to Mary for putting this together and sharing such a unique and multi-layered perspective on the text that you presented and the rather alarming tools of the trade that you have in front of you now, the tools of the trade past. So thank you, and an enormous round of applause from me. Here's my Zoom applause. Thank you to you both, and we will send out a follow-up message with links and such to the resources. As Natalie said at the beginning, this is the last event of the year for us. You can join us again in the new year. The first event is on January 11th. We are having a conversation with author Nancy Springer, who is the author of the Enola Holmes series. So a Victorian look at a fictional younger sister for Sherlock Holmes is what we have first on deck in January. Another female perspective on a male world. Thank you so much to you both, and thank you everyone for coming. And we wish you a very happy holidays. Thanks again.
Merci à tout le monde. Au revoir.
Merci beaucoup et au revoir. Ouais.